Chronicle Film critic Mick LaSalle will be right in this chair. He is my good buddy, my colleague. He and I never agree about new movies, but we really agree about one thing: classic Hollywood. We both have a passion for classic Hollywood. And he will be here to talk about early Hollywood women stars before the production code came to be. Women like Norma Shearer and Barbara Stanwyck and what they were all doing before they were told they had to behave themselves. So we'll talk about early female movie stars in Hollywood with Mick LaSalle. He's going to be teaching a class about it. We'll give you all that information as well. So lots going on. I'd like to dedicate the show tonight to a man who passed away this week, Brandon Tartikoff. I was lucky enough to talk to Brandon.
That night, for me, just me and you. Johnny, we did it. Connect the phone, and when we're all alone, we'll have a lot to do. Oh, darling, I've got to celebrate, and I can hardly wait until we do. Johnny, I hope you realize that there's a big surprise.
Whoa, great lyrics, very racy, wonderful hat, and the divine Miss Dietrich. Oh, does it get much better? Well, it all happened before the production code. That's when movies could really be a lot of fun. And here is a man who knows all about what happened to women in Hollywood before the production code took over and made them repent for their sins. Yeah. Here he is right here, Mick LaSalle from the San Francisco Chronicle.
Yes.
And my good friend.
Yes.
It's so nice to have you here.
It's very good to be here, and it's great. That Dietrich film is very, very rare. You can never see it. It's not on video, and also because it's owned by Universal, they never let it out. So this is good. I got a hold of a good tape of this, and I'm going to be showing it.
Now explain to people about the production code.
Sure.
And Joseph Breen and all of that.
Okay, well, in June of 1934, actually July of 1934, the censors finally won. It was a struggle for about 4 or 5 years to control screen content. And Joseph Breen was a more reactionary member of this production code administration, and he figured out a way to bring the studios to their knees by hooking up with the Catholic Legion of Decency.
That's where, because between 30 and 34, they were letting it slide.
Oh, 29 to 34 is that, as soon as the talkies started really doing, yeah, it was, and that's why, you know, people wanted to put a clamp on it, and people from the left and the right, mm-hmm. You know, the kind of the thought police of both sides.
Was it the females that were scaring them? Females like Dietrich and Shearer and Stanwyck and Davis? Well, who was scaring them so bad?
Well, it's good you should say that, because I think to a large extent it was that. I mean, people at the time complained about the crime movies, the violence, things like the things that people complain about now, only they were complaining about, you know, something on a much lesser scale. But the women, I think, were the most threatening. And, 1934 also coincides with a major, major feminist backlash that was the result of the Depression. Working women who were married were suddenly very, very suspect, because the idea was that they were taking jobs away from families, you know, from men who had families. So all of a sudden, you know, the pendulum was beginning to swing that way. So there's a lot of feeling of threat from women, unfortunately. Yeah.
So before the code, you had women who were sexual in movies,
yeah,
and kind of rejoicing in their sexuality and not getting busted for it at the end of the film.
Yeah, not dying at the end of the film or crying or doing anything. I mean, the real test of you, there are some movies that were remade in the 40s and 50s that were made in the 30s, and always the early 30s version is better, because it's more honest. The women they get away with it, or if they don't get away with it completely, they get away with it much more than they did at any time until you get to about the mid-60s. And so the women of this period are more recognizably women as, you know, human beings, as we know what, you know, people to be, than anything that happened in the 40s or 50s, or even, you know, there's a lot of bubblehead action going on in the 60s, and especially in the first half of the 60s. So that I find that the women of the code are very, mm-hmm, are very much like the women of today.
Right, especially career-wise, I find, and sexually, but career-wise, yeah, of whatever it takes. Climb your way up, you know. Get that career going. Make
it
happen.
Yes.
That kind of ambition is there with Crawford, with Stanwyck.
Well, a good example, there's a movie called Mary Stevens, M.D., with Kay Francis, mm-hmm. where the end of the movie, she is able to save a child's life because she takes a hairpin out of her hair, and then at the end of it, she says, "What could, you know, could a male doctor have done this?" About a year and a half later, you get a movie called The Flame Within with Anne Harding, where she's a psychiatrist, and the happy ending of that movie is she gives up her practice. And there's example after example of that. So in the code, women do not apologize for having careers or you know, for making money or being independent. So it's a very, very interesting time, and kind of what it does, it's very reassuring to people, because when you see that, you say, oh, I get it. It was propaganda that we were fed, and this is what people were always like, or at least always could have been like and wanted to be. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's a very useful thing to see these movies, just not only as entertainment, though they're wonderfully entertaining too.
Yeah, and you're going to be teaching a class on this,
yes.
which we will tell people the information. So I'm warning you now, please get a pen and a piece of paper, because in our next little segment with Nick LaSalle, we're going to give you the information of his class. It's an exciting class, because Nick has a passion. Whenever you have a passion for something, it makes it a wonderful thing to teach.
Oh, absolutely. No, I wouldn't do this for no money, but I can tell you I'm not doing it for the money. I'm doing it for fun. I mean, this is Monday night, and I found that when I taught it the last time, I wouldn't mind the weekend ending. I would say, oh, goody, you know, I get to teach this class on Monday.
Right.
So, yeah, it's so much fun.
You know, you and I really share something. We both have to sit through a lot of bad new movies.
Oh, sure, yeah.
And both of us love classic Hollywood,
yeah.
which is really how we met many years ago.
Yeah.
It was kind of through classic Hollywood.
Yeah.
And if I didn't have that love, I don't know, I could put up with what I
really?
Have to sit through. Do you feel that way?
No, I don't. To me, the pre-code movies are very much like the movies of today. And it's the films, I think if I had to sit through movies from the 50s, I would crack up.
I see.
But movies of today, I mean, we see everything. You know, if you're a film critic, and most of any era, you know, is bad. It's just the way it is. But when I don't compare going to the movies now with what it might have been like to go to the movies another time. What I compare, when I go to a movie now as a critic, I compare it to a job I had digging ditches or something, which I did once. I did have a job
and
digging
this is
ditches.
Much better,
sitting in a movie theater and suffering through a bad movie
better.
Is not like digging ditches.
I know. It's better than waitressing, too.
Yeah, I can imagine.
Now, Norma Shearer, we're about to see a clip of Norma
yeah,
Shearer.
Yeah.
This is a lady that has a special place in your heart.
Well, I like Norma Shearer is great because I know people make fun of me because I like Norma Shearer.
I'm not making fun of you.
No, not you.
Yeah,
no, but I do, because it's kind of, she's been kind of critically discounted over the years because people don't know her early 30s films. She got kind of queenly in her late 30s movies.
Well, she was sleeping with the boss, as Joan Crawford
would say. Joan Crawford would say,
But
Joan
Crawford,
a lot of sour grapes on Joan Crawford's part.
Right, but that's another story.
That is another story. The early 30s Shearer films, because Shearer had such a good reputation, she was able to push the boundaries of what a woman could get away with on screen farther than anybody. And so her films, I think, are the great feminist documents of the time, because she didn't play floozies. She played regular women.
And what are we going to see? Strangers May Kiss.
Strangers May Kiss. This is good because she lets out with a statement at the beginning of this clip that you don't expect. But then you expect her having to back off it and repent from it. But instead, she turns the tables and tells off the guy in a nice way. You'll see.
All right, let's take a look at a moment from one of the movies that Nick LaSalle will be talking about when he teaches this class in Pre-Code Women. Ooh, I love this. I'm going to have to show it myself. Right now, Norma Shearer, Strangers May Kiss, and we'll be back.
I'm in an orgy, wallowing, and I love it.
Yeah, well, I'm going to take you out of here and put you on your feet.
But I like standing on my head. Want to see me?
Oh, now be serious. If you think you can pull this sort of thing and get away with it, you're crazy. Pull yourself together. You and I are going to get out of here right now.
Oh, look here, Steve. What's the matter with you? You've been out for fun all your life. All you men are. I found that out. The sweet grand things that a girl dreams about don't interest men at all. They're just a nuisance.
Oh, you're wrong.
No, I'm not. If you'd wanted to do something for me, you could have begun a long time ago. Did you ever think that a two-fisted drinker wasn't the answer to my maiden's prayer?